So how has your Click Asia Summit experience been? What have you been up to and what kind of insights did you get and give your...
Okay, it was outstanding. More than giving any insights, there were a lot of insights I got because I'm as undigitized as they come. I'm more dyed in the wool, traditional content creator, so to speak. But all the way from Robert Scoble's session in the morning to the session in the evening with Aditi and Anubha, it was enlightening to say the least.
So there's a lot of talk about the digital world democratizing content, like everyone can create content. So you being a more traditional content creator, how does that make a difference to you? What do you make of it?
I'm saying it doesn't make a difference to me, but in terms of democratization of content, so to speak, see, that is precisely, there is a flip side to it. Yes, content is democratized, everyone can make content, but how much of that content is worth spending time over? How much of that content is really going to cut through? How much of that content is going to pull money? And how much of that content is going to justify the money that has been pulled?
Okay.
So therefore, the democratization of content, I said that word right, has of course two sides to it. Yeah.
So what kind of content do you like watching on the digital medium?
There is no particular kind or genre of content, and that is the beauty of it. There is all sorts of content, you know, and you can watch whatever takes your fancy at that particular point. But for example, if you, let's say, take a look at Indian comic content, everyone and their grandmother and their grandmother's pet pug, you know, who should I watch and why should I watch them and why should I be laughing all the time?
Okay.
Do we not have space for content which is not comic? Of course there is content which is not, you know, which is not comic, but how much of that content really is at the core?
So
I like watching all sorts of content.
That's what I was coming to. Like, humor seems to be like the big ticket when it comes to digital content. So how much of it, like, is there any good way or right way to do good comic content on digital?
No. Precisely, it's the nature of the medium. Yeah. What may be funny to you may not be funny to me, or vice versa. I might find AIB extremely funny, but might not find myself funny, for example.
Okay.
Or I don't know if I should be looking into this camera or I should be looking at you, and I'm doing both. So, there are viral things which, you know, friends have come to me and said, it's amazing. And I've sat to them and said, why does the world think this is amazing? I don't think it's funny at all.
So there is
no one right way, because it's a very personal experience, unlike a movie viewing experience, which is a community experience. Here it's you and that screen.
Is there a need for content creators to kind of update themselves on what's happening? Because even in terms of cameras, everything changes, the format changes, everything, the screen size changes. So do you feel the need to keep yourself updated?
As in, like the traditional method of content creation, or, you know, creating content for the digital space, one obviously needs to be updated, whether you're creating content as a writer, as an actor, or in whatever manner. Of course, you need to keep yourself updated.
Okay. So would you, as an artist, like to explore such options, which maybe have less money, but have more views, and it's more trackable, and it's more related to youth? So does that open up new avenues for you?
Money is very important. I'm also Gujarati. Plus, I'm an actor. I don't wake up if I don't get paid. See, that's another thing. So, at this point of time, you know, people are saying money will come. Money is coming. Money will come when?
Okay.
And how? And who? What is the sample size that money is going to be spread over? So, these are questions that I don't think have been entirely answered yet. So, for example, if there are 10,000 people creating content for the digital space today, how many of those will get paid? How many of those will survive? How many of those that do survive and do get paid, how many of those will survive happily? Or believe that they are getting bang for their buck, so to speak? These are questions that are unanswered yet. I mean, at least to me. And I'm, like I said, I'm as undigitized as they come. I haven't been able to get a hang on the business side of things yet.
So let's talk about the human side of things. The discussion that you were a part of also said that a lot of people spend hours on the internet without any human interaction. So what is your take on the newer generation being substituting human interaction for a virtual experience?
I think it's scary as shit, man. I really think it's scary as shit. And these are, of course, these are discussions and rants that we've heard over and over again from different people. They've been heard from us. We've discussed it. And it's the world is discussing it. So I really, that answer is a foregone conclusion.
Okay.
There needs to be, you really need to strike a balance. Or bounce a ball, yeah.
Hmm. So do you think in a country that is so close-knit and people are literally breathing down each other's necks, so is substituting virtual reality a possibility? Like even if you're in a train with a virtual reality gadget, there's always going to be this uncle who is just like breathing down your neck. So how unreal can we get?
If you're sitting in a train with VR, on your face, and there's someone breathing down your neck, you wouldn't care really. That person breathing down your neck would want to go into your head and, "Abey, is it samandar mein? Nahi bhai, mahim ki khadi." So no, but no, that really wouldn't matter. Yeah. VR again, I don't know. Yeah, if we see people on trains using VR, that would be like, dude, scary shit. That's like a dystopian future you're speaking of. Yeah, that's like a movie, man. Imagine, there's like people going to work, there's no space for people to stand, but everyone has one VR headset on it. Minds come and gone.
Okay, so one thing that kind of scared you at Click Asia, and one thing that you're really looking forward and you think you'll go back and think about it and talk about it or research about it.
One thing that really scared me at Click Asia was being at Click Asia. Because I had no head or tail of why I've been asked to be here. Like I said, I'm as undigitized as they come. I had no clue what I was going to say or what the discussion was going to be about. And what I'm taking away with me is the entire day, because it's been extremely enlightening. And what I would be looking forward to would be streamlining the content I create for the digital medium. And, you know, I was in the presence of greatness on stage with Aditi and Anubhav today, and that by itself is amazing.
So you work at Blog Adda. So are you aware of what bloggers do in this country? And yeah, okay, so would you like to give them any kind of advice? Because at the end of the day, even they are content creators.
Absolutely. Blog. So that is not a road I have gone down, but I have close friends who do blog about their personal experiences. Ek second ke liye coffee banana mat.
Just a sec, 2 minutes.
I don't know, not being a blogger myself, I don't know what advice I could give bloggers, but I don't read everyone who blogs. So why do I not? Why do I pick and choose to read bloggers that I do? Either it's because they write about something, they blog about something, they create content about something that interests me, or that the blog just knocks my socks off, you know. So yeah, I mean, you need to get into a space. Again, it's one second.
Yeah.
So I'm saying, yeah, that blog needs to knock my socks off. I don't think I would be in a space to be able to advise bloggers. Yeah. Because anyone who has the courage to go out there and blog by itself, it takes a lot of courage.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.